half an hour, 40 minutes. Yeah. All right, welcome. So we're beginning a new series today, which is on, which is on delving into the feminine, feminine as an energy. So it's something that's personally very close to my heart as a subject. Not only as a woman, but also because over the years, it's, I guess it's been the common thread in terms of all the work that I've been doing around, you know, various streams of life. So, and of course, to clarify, we're here when we say delving into the feminine, we're not talking of feminist movements or women's liberation or any of that. We're here, we're talking about the masculine and the feminine energies in us, and the utility of it is not only in terms of healing. Yes, of course, there is a huge amount of scope of healing using the understanding of the inner feminine and the inner masculine, but it leads to so much more. And it, in a way, if you look at the world through this lens, there is so much clarity that it brings, and also there is clarity also in terms of what needs to shift in us and outside of us. So today being the first part of the series, the idea is to just look at feminine as a concept and understand that, and then we'll move on from there into the series.
You have to go through the females all over again, right?
Well, you need to access your feminine, you don't need to become a woman. Yeah.
It's a calling.
Yeah.
I don't know that. Oh,
trust me, you know. All men know. Yeah, so, something that's a very basic concept in this realm is that of the anima. Are we familiar with that term? Anima and animus. Yeah. So, Carl Jung proposed the term anima and animus. And what he meant by that was that every man, as in like a genetically born male, has an inner woman, and then every woman who's genetically born female will have an inner man, right? So the inner feminine is the anima, and the inner masculine is called the animus, right? So while in one sense they are polar concepts, they function very differently, right? So the animus has a totally different function in a woman as compared to the anima in a man. And one of the reasons I wanted to explore this topic further was also to look at initiating a discussion in terms of what's happening in the world today, and looking at what is it that we as individuals can do to ourselves, to the community around us, in this particular perspective. So if you look at the recent past, that there has been a lot of talk, and the media has been writing a lot of things on it, and we've also seen events happening around the world around what we may term the emergence of the feminine. Right? In the sense, recently the Pope said that homosexuality is okay, he doesn't have a judgment against it. The Dalai Lama commented that the next Dalai Lama may very well be a woman. Right? So there is that shift of, or we may not get any, yes. There is all this talk in India about women wanting to enter certain temples and fighting for access for it. So in that sense, there has been a lot of emergence of the feminine in various forms, and emergence in the sense of allowing the feminine to enter into areas which were traditionally considered masculine for whatever reasons. And those reasons were very valid in the time that those reasons were birthed, but at some point we've moved beyond those reasons. So at this stage in history, and as a collective human race, it is becoming more and more essential to look at where is the inner balance between the masculine and the feminine, and interestingly, how is that manifesting in the outside world, right? So one of the things that Carl Jung also propounded was that while So Freud spoke about the fact that there is a conscious and the unconscious, right? So all of us have a conscious mind, which we are aware of, things that we are aware of in terms of thoughts or opinions or judgments, emotions, all of that is in the conscious. And there is an unconscious which drives us. It's not something that we are aware of, and therefore we are unable to control it, in as many words. So something like, let's say, murderous rage in which I go and bash up a person largely comes from the unconscious, because I'm not consciously making a decision to go kill a person. It happens in that moment, something drives me, and at a later point I may regret it, I may choose to justify it, but the point is, yeah, but at that point I didn't make a conscious choice, it happened, and then I tried to figure out what happened. So the unconscious functions in various ways. It may also function in positive ways. So it's not that unconscious is bad and conscious is good. It works both ways. So Freud propounded that there are both these aspects. There are parts of self that we are aware of and we actively work with, parts of ourselves that we are not aware of, and therefore we don't control. Carl Jung took it a first step further to say that yes, there is a conscious, there is an unconscious, but there is also a personal conscious and a collective conscious, and there is a personal unconscious and a collective unconscious. So, and that's where he also, since he brought up the term, in the context of the collective unconscious is where he brought up the term archetype. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we hold archetypes in the collective, and therefore even if we may not have physical or experiential access to certain concepts, we still have a certain expectation of certain concepts, right? So there are various kinds of archetypes. So Carl Jung, of course, in his contemporary times, he spoke of archetypes like kings and queens and, you know, mother and nurses and doctors. But there are several other archetypes that we hold. Like if I were to now at this point use the word politician, right? So yeah, the archetype throws up things like corruption, right? Because that's what the collective at this moment is holding. Yeah. Right? If I were to perhaps throw up the term politician in 1947, yeah, perhaps a different kind of image would have conjured, that it could be probably patriots, about fighters and people who, yeah, patriots and statesmen, right? So the collective archetypes change. Right? Now, for us to have an archetype of a politician such as this doesn't necessarily mean we personally know a politician or have ever met one or interacted with one. It's just there. Right? Similarly, an archetype of, let's say, a nurse or a more distant one would be like, let's say, a nun, you know, like a missionaries of charities nun kind of a thing. If I throw up the archetype of a nun, the typical image that's conjured is that of somebody who's kind and in service and loving, sister, right? So when I say nun, it's very unlikely that you're going to be thinking of somebody rude and cruel, and because that's not the archetype that we hold, right? So, and the anima is also an archetype like that. Right? So, it is something that the collective holds. And like all other archetypes in the collective, the anima also shifts with time. Which is why when we speak of the current evolutionary process as a process of emergence of the feminine, it is because the archetype somewhere is shifting in the collective, not only for men, but also for women.
But then collective, you mean a belief at that time to time?
Yes. So there is
because that,
you know,
is again propagated to from generations.
Yes. So the collective consciousness manifests in the form of customs, traditions at that point in time, collective beliefs, right? So like if you look at a collective belief during the Victorian era, for example, if a woman showed her ankles, she was characterless. So that there is a collective archetype that's being held at that point about what a woman should be like. Right? But now, if I say woman in a miniskirt, that's okay in a lot of parts of the world. Right? So the collective keeps shifting. And of course, there are various theories both in physics and in psychology about what holds this collective together. I mean, where is it stored? Is it some kind of a memory box somewhere? So yeah, quantum physics has been doing a lot of work around this also. To put it in a simple way, most of these theories at this point speak of a force field that is visible. That is not visible to the naked eye, but the force field seems to exist. And a lot of research has corroborated the existence of the force field. Yeah, Sheldrake and Robert Keyes. Robert Keyes happened a long, long time ago, but the monkeys, the 100th monkey phenomenon.
He termed that morphic field or something.
Yeah. So, a similar code of morphogenetic field is used when you're working with the family lineage that we were speaking about. But yeah, so what they mean by a force field is that there seems to be some kind of a critical mass of belief that reaches in the force field. And at that point, that becomes a collective archetype. It somehow gets imbibed by everybody who wants to imbibe. So, which was the experiment that Robert Keyes did way back in the 50s or 60s? It's quite some time ago. So, that experiment, for those of you who are not familiar, was that these scientists were researching about a certain breed of monkeys on an island off the Japanese coast. And these monkeys had a habit of having sweet potatoes. So they would dig it out from the ground and eat. So apparently one of those days, one baby monkey accidentally dropped the sweet potato in a stream that was flowing by. It picked it up and ate, and then it realized, oh, this tastes better because the mud has washed off. And somewhere in this, whatever social process the monkeys have, that baby monkey taught its friends how to wash sweet potatoes. And at some point in time, over a period of a few days, all the monkeys on that island started to wash and eat, and they figured that it's tastier that way. And
they became normal people. They became normal people.
No, they didn't become people. They were still whatever they were. But the interesting thing was, a team that was parallelly researching the same breed of monkeys in Australia, one fine day reported that all monkeys there suddenly have started washing their sweet potatoes. Yeah. So somewhere they figured that there is some kind of a critical mass that needs to be reached for the belief to get picked up, for in human terms, for a tradition to get entrenched or a custom to get familiar popular. So there seems to be some kind of a critical mass. We don't know how much or what that critical mass is yet. So, which is why even in the context of things like nuclear weapons, people are talking about what critical mass needs to shift to for us to stop producing nuclear weapons. So, back to the anima. So, anima is the unconscious feminine in a man. Right? Now, of course, I'm talking of it from the theoretical perspective that Carl Jung put it. As we go ahead into this exploration, we're not necessarily talking of men and women, we're talking of humans as a collective and what do we do with this. So the anima has manifestations in multiple ways. Of course, there is also a physical manifestation of the anima in the sense that the male body, no matter how long we've evolved, still has female organs that it has no actual use for, but it's still there as a presence of the anima. The nipples have no use in men, but it's still there. Men still produce estrogen that's not particularly required. Right? So in that sense, the physical existence of the anima is very prevalent. And it, depending on how much the anima is assimilated, the development of the man gets influenced. So, one of the most important aspects of the anima is what's called the autonomous complex, and the anima builds the autonomous complex. That if the more the anima is suppressed, the more it will result in what we might term, for lack of a better word, perverted behavior. Yeah. So the sensitivities get repressed if the anima is not allowed to explore itself, and therefore the behavior in a social context gets impacted. With practically all men, the anima appears in dreams in the form of various women that you may know, women that you may not know. Typically in the form of female figures that appear in dreams, that is the anima manifesting itself, the inner feminine trying to communicate with the conscious mind. And of course, needless to say, the inner feminine does influence your behavior and your relationships with the actual women in your world. And Carl Jung believed that interaction with your anima is a very healthy thing, and the more active the interaction, the more creative and innovative you can get, the more value you can bring into the world. Similarly, for the interaction of a woman with her animus, the more healthy the interaction, the greater the productivity and the emotional balance as well. Emotional balance, the physical health balance also gets impacted if the anima or the animus is repressed.
Sister, any relation with yogic anima, siddhima, yet siddhi?
Yes. In fact, there is a lot of mythological reference of extreme assimilation of the anima or the animus. There are, I forget the name of that king, the king who gets pregnant, one of the Ikshvaku dynasty kings. Ram's dynasty, the one of the later kings who gets pregnant, that's extreme assimilation. Ikshvaku dynasty, I don't remember, something with a Y, Yashovardhan or Yashovan or some name, I don't remember the name of the person. But yeah, there is, of course, I mean, traditionally the story has been about, you know, gets pregnant by mistake kind of a thing. But yeah, well, if you look, read through the story, it is about the fact that you don't need an external woman. You can be as productive within if you're able to assimilate and imbibe those energies. Similarly, there have also been, parallelly, Mahabharata has some story of a woman who gets pregnant by herself.
Yeah.
Right? And yeah, that. No, so, but no, it is a biological shift which has been documented as a story format, and because we've lost the historical context, we treat it as mythology. We think it's too fantastic. But if you read through the story, you figure out the psychological process behind it.
Because in Kunti's process also,
yes,
though it is, I mean, it may be like what we did here in scientific age, like test tube.
Test tubes, yeah.
So it must be at that time,
I mean, it's the more you read into it, it feels like it has been a allegorical representation of something. It's not actual, you know. So what they mean is, yeah, that those incidents could have happened. Why they happened is a deeper process. It's not just magic or fantasy.
The power becomes slow, a smaller particle, this anima.
Yes. Not so much yogas, but what the siddhic practices work with is a lot of the anima and the animus also. The siddhas who work
they got the power to become
slow. Yeah, so siddhic practices can control to an extreme degree. You can live without food, you can, what do they call those people? Photomorphic people who just live on light. And there are actual people living in the world like that. So yeah, those are possible. Yes. So, Carl Jung spoke about how the anima develops in a man, in the typical stages of development. Of course, he used what we may term as biblical archetypes, because I mean he came from that context. But those names could very well be replaced with any contextual, you know, name. So what he proposes is that every man in his relationship with the inner feminine, the first relationship is of looking at the feminine as Eve, as the mother. I mean, Eve being the ultimate mother of the race. So, obviously, because for most people, the first interaction with a female human is the mother, and therefore, the relationship with the inner feminine is that it needs to be somebody who's nurturing, who needs to provide for me, who doesn't have any expectation from me, and you know, I can demand anything and I can get it because that's what a mother does, right? So there is that unconditional service being offered from the inner.
Out of care.
Yeah, out of care. Yeah. So that's the first relationship with the inner feminine as well. At this point of development, and it doesn't necessarily mean that the Eve stage lasts only till you're a child or an infant. Some men live through their lives in the Eve stage. The development just doesn't go further for various reasons. Right? One of it could be that you could possibly have a terrible experience with a mother, whatever reason. You know, it could, instead of a mother, it could be a stepmother who was not very good with you, or you didn't have a great relationship with your own mother for whatever reason. And in that process, the constant search for Eve continues all through. And therefore, that kind of a person is very likely to look for a mother in a wife or a girlfriend. Right? So, and that causes a lot of conflict because that's not the role that the outer woman would want to play, but the man still unconsciously expects the woman to play that role. And it works both ways. For all the archetypes, the man would either seek the exact replica of it. For example, the replica of the mother, he may look for a wife who's exactly like the mother. Or the other extreme, he will look for a polar opposite if the experience with the mother is bad. Yeah. But either way, there is a projection of Eve onto, projection of the mother onto the other women in his life. Doesn't necessarily have to be the significant other, all women, friends, relatives. That projection continues all through, and that in a way warps the social connect. Because you're coming from a certain space where the inner feminine is stuck even as you are growing. The progression from Eve is to what Carl Jung spoke of as the Helen stage, where at some point, if you do get over in the sense assimilate, which primarily in a psychic context would mean that you accept the fact that yes, you were mothered and you were mothered well and you've had enough nurturance in your life. At some point, the archetype shifts into being Helen. When he said Helen, Carl Jung referred to Helen of Troy. Right. So the archetype being that of a flirtatious woman who was married and yet wanted to be with somebody else, and there was a whole war of Troy that happened because of her. So the archetype of the woman changes to that of being flirtatious, of wanting love, romance, and to some degree, again, depending on what the environment also imposes into the archetype, this archetype could mean bad character, or it could just mean, you know, that's how it is. So this is typically the stage where the relationship with a woman shifts to being romantic, flirtatious, adventurous. There is an element of risk in the relationship that starts happening at this point in time. Again, depending upon the experience at this moment, the relationship can go back and forth. So let's say if a person happens to be a teenager and also happens to be in the Helen stage, and if you happen to have a couple of healthy relationships with women, whether it's girlfriends or otherwise, you move on because you assimilate and figure out that, okay, you can have a healthy relationship, you can have romance in a healthy relationship, and therefore you're open to evolving those kind of relationships further. If for whatever reason that relationship turns out to be bad, there is a possibility of getting psychologically stunted at that point in time, where then the projection of Helen continues on all women in your life. So no matter how faithful or loyal a wife you get, there the suspicion remains that what is she doing, because somewhere psychically you're stuck, the anima is stuck, and therefore no matter how evolved your outer relationship is, the element of trust and that element of fun gets stunted. The next stage, if you've engaged and assimilated the Helen stage, is what Carl Jung speaks of as the Mary stage, as in he referred to the Mother Mary. And what he meant by that was a woman who's worldly wise, a woman who is capable of being a mother and capable of being independent. And therefore, there is a, at this point, there is a weaning off that happens from the feminine. Weaning off in the sense, the more the assimilation, the more the weaning off. You're not dependent on and have to hold on to the feminine. You start respecting the feminine as a part of you, and therefore there is no need to hold on. It exists. It becomes parallel play at some point. Right? So the archetype of the Mother Mary is used because she's considered a fairly independent woman who birthed Jesus, who equally let go of Jesus without the drama around the process.
Is it a position of a sort of an advisor?
Not so much an advisor, but somebody who's getting to be confident and independent. And yeah, in that sense, yeah, somebody who's an equal that you can speak to.
Okay, you take caring also?
But nurturing also, but in the sense the woman continues to remain a woman.
Kindly you get away from
yes.
it as an observer.
Okay. Yeah. So there is a worldly wise quality around it, and therefore the relationship with, if that's the relationship with the inner feminine, the relationship with the outer feminine is also that of equals, to say that, yeah, I am me, you are as capable and as independent as you are, and therefore I don't need to take care of you. Or, you know, like if you look at the Helen archetype, the relationship with the outer women is that I have to come and rescue you, I have to fight a war for you, right? So, and it's interesting to see that in different parts of the world in terms of how is the anima operating in the collective. If you look at the Middle East, for example, the anima is very much stuck at the Helen stage, and therefore, if you look at the cultural, socio-cultural norms, it is about men having to protect women, and you can't go out alone as a woman unless you have a male family member accompanying you. Women can't dress like this, women can't do certain things. So all those rules happen when the relationship is the Helen stage, where the relationship with the inner feminine is that you have to be controlled, you have to be restrained, otherwise you run away. And therefore that impacts the culture of the society. The culture is more restrained for women outside, because the inner feminine is
so
somewhere
that is
here.
Prominent.
Yeah. So it's interesting to see how they've evolved over the years. Unlike if you look at Europe.
And again, that is right? Because of collective consciousness at that
there. Yeah. So and that's the reason now. It's interesting to explore this, because the more men explore their inner feminine, the culture changes around. Right? So the more men get into a healthy relationship with that Helen stage, culture shifts. Right? And we saw that shift happening in Europe, right? That they moved from the Victorian stage where they actually said what women need to wear and how they should behave, to being a thing of equals, where we said, okay, women are as capable as men, you work, you do whatever you want to do as the same as men do.
Wrong.
Yeah. So somewhere the anima developed in the collective, which for whatever reason did not happen in the Middle East at a collective level. Right? So you see that happening in different pockets of the world, actually showcase different levels of the anima. Yes.
Outer relationship reflects inner relationship.
Yes, absolutely. So if you look at your relationships with women in your life, whether it's your mother or wife or girlfriend or sister, female friends, and look at what those relationships look like, you will have an idea of where you are. Right? What are your expectations of those women? What are your behaviors with those women? And that is a reflection on what the inner feminine looks like.
Helen is
not
blind.
No,
that
no.
Is different.
No, not Helen Keller. This is Helen of
Helen
Troy.
Of Troy.
Yeah. No, what he meant was Helen of Troy, who caused the Trojan War. The Achilles and Hector. No, the Trojan horse.
Soldier.
Yeah.
Trojan horse.
So that's a different Helen, and this is Mary. So that's a Mary stage, where the stage of that is that of equals, that I respect my feminine and I allow her to coexist in me, and I see the value in her. I see the fact that she is creative, she can give birth, and if I allow myself to use that, I can get innovative, I can get creative, right? And to a great degree, if you look at it from a psychosocial point of view, the Industrial Revolution was caused because of access to that energy, where men said, okay, women can come out and work. So that the collective shifted into saying, okay, equal, and therefore let's use that energy. Yeah. That energy is otherwise not available if you're somewhere down the line. Right? And the final stage is, of course, what Carl Jung says is the stage of the Sophia. Sophia is wisdom. Okay. Sophia is the Greek. Sophie is the Latin term for wisdom. So, Sophia is a stage where the inner feminine is so evolved that it leads you into a stage of psycho-spiritual development. So, the search for meaning, the search for value creation comes from the Sophia, from the inner Sophia. So, men that have questioned things in the world, wanted to create value for the world. I mean, somebody like, let's say, a Swami Vivekanand, or even Jesus to a great extent. If you look at those archetypes, there's extreme assimilation of the feminine, and therefore
Viktor Frankl,
yeah, of course, he very directly looked at the search for meaning. And incidentally, that came through his relationship with his wife.
Correct.
Right? Viktor Frankl's journey was about going in this concentration camp, and he was walking without shoes in the snow, and they were going to some labor place, and he wanted to give up. And somewhere he had a picture in his mind of his wife, and some part of him said, it's possible that she's alive and I might live to see her someday. And therefore that gives me meaning to live in this moment. And he lived and survived the war. So yeah, that's the extreme, where there's absolute assimilation of the woman to an extent where she becomes the source of wisdom. Right? So she in you becomes the source of wisdom.
Yeah? And that becomes, I think, driving force.
Yeah, that becomes the driving force, yeah. So there are various lenses with which we can look at it. One is purely from the psychological concept point of view, and what we can do in terms of our own development and healing our relationships in the process. There is the collective lens of what's happening in the world and what can we as individuals do to shift in us, which will actually shift the collective. And that's an important role for each of us to play, because we don't know what the critical mass is, and every one person shifting makes a difference to that critical mass. And of course, the other lens is to look at what kind of emotional healing can we provide for ourselves through this reflection of where we are in terms of our development.
Actually, this is very good tool for self-improvement.
Absolutely, it is. Yeah. So there are various lenses in which this subject can be approached, which was the reason I was tempted to choose this as the next series, to see what are the various lenses in which we can use this individually and personally, collectively. So the role of the anima, again coming back to the psychological concept of it, the role of the anima is largely seen as that of being the guide to the unconscious. The anima is the one that leads the conscious into the unconscious. And a lot of times, depending on what conditioning and what society we grow up with, the path to the unconscious is sometimes considered scary. Some traditions encourage it, some traditions very clearly don't encourage it. So that's the path in itself is something that needs to get cleared to begin with. Regardless of whether the path is clear or not, the anima exists and the anima will keep continuing to show up in different ways. Initially in the dreams, later in behavior. And the more she shows up, the more the call for engagement to work with her and to get over those stages, to accept the nurturance that you receive. It may or may not be from a biological mother. It doesn't really matter whether the nurturance comes from a woman or not. Any nurturance that you receive, if it can be assimilated, the Eve stage gets done. And then there is the Helen stage and the Mary and the Sophia.
Caretaker?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. Eve is the caretaker, the mother.
In prehistoric man, they used to go out for hunting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Woman used to be at home.
Yes.
Take care of children.
Yeah. That's why. So, which is why the more the... if you look at those stages from left to right, the more the equanimity in the equation, right? Eve stage is about saying that, okay, I am this alpha male, I'm going to go kill that lion, you stay back in the cave, you produce kids, right? So the relationship with the feminine is very distant. It's about saying, you're there, I'm here, and I'm this alpha male, right? And the more the integration, the more you move into the right, there is integration to say, I am man and I'm also woman. And there is comfort in that. It doesn't mean you biologically change or become a woman. It's about the fact that there's respect for the male psychic side of you, which is the male psychic side is that of somebody who acts, who executes things, who goes, does things. The feminine side is the one that brings in compassion, that brings in that sense of communication, collaboration, and both of them are equally necessary. And
as you move, you are merging both them.
Yeah. So it is an energetic merger. It doesn't really change physiological sex identity. It's a matter of psychic identity shifts. Yeah. And at a collective, if you look at our world today, it is important that we access more of both, because somewhere over the years we've learned to access the masculine more, right? And even for women, a lot of women operate as masculine in the world. We don't operate as feminine because that's not something that we are taught to access, and it's not even something that's appreciated when you access it. So women are, even if you look at a traditional role of a housewife, right, a homemaker role, you will find a lot of homemakers who are very masculine in their approach. They're not really accessing the inner feminine.
Yes.
Right? So the masculine approach is in terms of...
education system and everything is to become not exactly aggressive,
yeah. But
go out, do it confidently.
Yeah. And therefore, aspects like creativity or nurturance or compassion are not really appreciated. So you may still do it, but no one really cares. So therefore you learn to project the masculine more, and therefore you will find...
Whole bread butter is based on that.
Yeah. So therefore you will find women who may be donning traditional roles, they may be homemakers, but they'll be extremely masculine in terms of pushing their kids, and you have to come first in class, and you have to go to that swimming class, and you have to do this, and there is a very masculine approach right? And therefore, a lot of those kids, in spite of having a full-time mom at home, don't get past the Eve stage. Because somewhere there is an obsessive masculine that is in the found in the mother, and therefore the child is still looking for the mother even as he grows up to be a man. Because somewhere he's not found the mother yet. The mother has unconsciously been playing the role of a father. So the kid has grown up with two fathers, two father energies, and therefore is still looking for the mother.
They lose their emotional intelligence because they are not accessing their own qualities.
Yes.
He will be attracted to same.
So normally the.
Who has more of that dominance?
That is one possibility. Some others go to the polarity of saying that, okay, I want a girlfriend who will mother me. You know, yeah, that happens because you're somewhere psychically you're looking for a mother, right? You although you've had a mother, you've not got the mother energy. So therefore you're looking for nurturance from your female companion. Yeah.
And in many marriages this happens sometimes.
Yeah. And somewhere the obviously because this is not a conscious process, that woman who comes in doesn't realize what's happening in the relationship. So it takes a long time to figure out that okay, he's not wanting a girlfriend, he wants a mother.
A child loses his mother, maybe due to divorce or whatever.
Yeah.
How would it affect him, his upbringing? And let's say a 4 or 5 year old.
It depends on the context, right? He may lose a biological mother, but if there is somebody playing the role of the mother in the environment, it's very well compensated. Okay. Yeah. It's not that the person will stop feeling sorry about the loss of the mother, but the person may not necessarily get stuck just because some other relative, sometimes the father may be able to play that role of nurturing. Okay? So, not necessary that biological loss will also mean there is a psychic loss. It could very well be compensated.
Okay. Yeah. So, it shouldn't have any complex. It shouldn't grow up. I mean, could be normal, you say?
Yeah, very well could be normal. Okay. Yes, absolutely.
Supporting atmosphere is
important. Yeah. So, the feminine is the nurturance, is the... So, I mean, if you look at a lot of spiritual literature, the analogy for the feminine is the river,
yes.
Right? And the masculine is the banks that hold the river. Mm-hmm. And both are equally important. If the banks don't hold, the river floods. And they're the same river that nurtures and helps to grow crops can also destroy homes if the banks don't hold. So that's the role of both. So both the anima and the animus are equally important, but of course the animus functions very differently in women, and we're not getting into that space yet. But yeah, that's the very crucial role of the anima, and I think it's time that you and me explore where is the anima in us and how do we deal with it internally and in the collective? And of course, when I say role of the anima, I don't necessarily mean men. Women also need to explore that just as equally, because a lot of us have grown up as males, as masculine, not males, but masculine. Yeah. So that's that for today. We'll continue exploring this in the series.
Great. Yeah. It was very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.